Hello and welcome to Digital Nation, your weekly view of the UK through the lens of reporters from the local TV channels. In this week's show, we set our feet a-tapping in Edinburgh. We visit an 18th century ice house in Birmingham. And get snappy with some crocodiles in Oxfordshire. Don't forget, you can contact us using the hashtag DigitalNation. Virtual reality is becoming more popular by the day, but did you know you can have virtual pets? Well, our first visit this week is to a Cambridge community college, helping students understand the importance of teamwork and respect of the environment, using a virtual cat called Cinder. It still needs daily feeding and lots of playful attention, though.
A feline friend like no other. Cinder is the first augmented reality cat of her kind in the UK. Developed alongside students at her new home in Trumpington Community College, the school pet's intended to teach young people about working in a team and respecting the environment.
Like any pet cat, Cinder needs looking after, and it's the mutual responsibility of the students here to make sure she's fed and played with. But this cat has special abilities. She's able to grow in size, change her colour, and even don a cap if the mood takes her.
It's kind of really modern to have this in your school because not many schools have the privilege.
Cinder was developed by the technology company Umbrellium through workshops with the college's students. The task, to come up with a piece of artwork for the new school that reflects the college ethos and fits in with the building's high-tech sustainability systems.
Working with them, first of all, to understand all the complexity of the building itself, but secondly, to sort of understand what were the bits that they might be able to make decisions about, or what were the bits that they could most readily grapple with.
For the students, Cinder's an added dimension to the school day, introducing new technology and a sense of camaraderie. And as students pass through, it's hoped the college cat will become a lasting memory of their school days.
We travel to Edinburgh now, where as part of its sell-out nationwide tour, hit musical Billy Elliot is in town for a five-week run. With a travelling entourage of tutors and chaperones to take care of the 28 young performers, STV caught up with two of the dancers chosen to play the lead role and find out what it's like to be part of the successful show.
I've pirouetted my way down to the Edinburgh Playhouse as Billy Elliot is in town for 5 weeks only. Now, it's the only Scottish run, and did you know that there's four actors who play Billy? I'm about to meet two of them, Adam and Matthew, plus Billy's dad, played by Martin Walsh, but it's a busy schedule for these kids. They've got school in the morning, they've got rehearsals, the show at night, it's time to crack on.
Is it quite hard to pretend that you don't know how to dance, yet you do really know how to dance?
It's quite easy, you just don't do it.
Yeah,
it's like the easy bit of the show before it gets super hard.
Do you get nervous at all?
I did at first when we started doing the shows, but now it's kind of just like come naturally and you don't really get that nervous anymore.
I've never done anything quite this length or quite this distance, and I've got two small kids of my own, so leaving them was quite hard, and still is, but you know, I try and work it all into the performance and channel it through these boys, and we work it that way. It's took obviously the original idea of the film, and then it's channeled it through the music and made more of a show of it, but it's, as I would say, it's sort of a musical for beginners. I was very much green to the musical scene, and it's got everything in it, this. It's got showstoppers, it's got real emotion, it's got grit.
Do you get into the ballet and tap there, Martin, at all? Do you follow these boys' leads? Or?
I'd say I'm not there for my dancing skills, but we have a go, yeah. These boys lead the way and we all try and tag along.
What's the best bit about being Billy Elliot?
At the end, in finale, seeing them all stand up and, like, clapping, and you know you've done well when they're all really happy.
My best bit is after electricity, because you've just done this 5 minute dance number with Dad watching and the audience all stand up and clap and you're just stood there and you're like, whoa.
Morecambe and Wise, in their heyday, were one of the top comedy double acts in the country, with millions watching their popular TV shows. They've now been immortalised by a statue in their spiritual home of Blackpool, with their families and close friends there to witness the unveiling.
When Eric and Ernie famously unveiled a glamorous Angela Rippon from behind her news desk, They played on the element of surprise, which was key to their comedy. Today, there was little surprise about what lay beneath this veil, but the duo have lost none of their power to delight.
It's very moving because everyone starts applauding and cheering when they see Eric and Eddie, and that's really been the secret of their career, is that people always feel, for some reason, really uplifted and good. So to be a main part of that, as in being part of the family, sure, you come to somewhere like Blackpool, which we've always regarded as their spiritual home, to have a statue there of the two of them together, and such an emotional looking one because of Eric and Ernie, always considered as almost being a unit, a single unit, and there they are with Eric hugging Ernie. You know, it's fantastic, it really is.
Two men who brought so many families together in their front rooms, now standing side by side in their home away from home.
I was the agent for Morecambe and Wise for many, many years with Billy Marsh, who was their main agent, and we looked after them all their career. Quite magical, very funny at times. Eric was the funny one, Ernie was the businessman, and he was the one that always dealt with the contracts.
Because people just love them. I love them. Even the kids now can watch the repeats and listen to all what they said, and they'll think, what a wonderful, clean, just wonderful humour. So let's hope that it will bring in Blackpool and people will come extra into Blackpool to see Eric and Ernie's lovely, lovely statue.
Even now, Eric and Ernie can still draw in the crowds here in Blackpool, as the double act did for so many years. And it's no doubt the addition of this statue will continue to bring plenty of sunshine to the seaside town.
As part of the season dedicated to the Bronte sisters, a new audio experience, Tiny Shoes, is a play set in the graveyard in Haworth. Visitors can immerse themselves in a 3D sound world whilst visiting the Bronte Parsonage Museum. Made in Leeds, brave the rain and don the headphones.
Kind of inspired by the Brontes, and it's inspired by a little bit by Jane Eyre and the life of Charlotte, but also the sisters. So there's lots of stuff in there that if you're a fan of Brontes you might recognise, but it's also not their story, it's an inspired by. So it's more like a story about a fan of the Brontes, but she has an imaginary Charlotte in her head.
It's the Bronte season at the minute, and Tiny Shoes is a little bit different than witnessing something in the theatre. It's coming here to the Parsonage. I've been able to listen to an audio and go around the graveyard.
Well, you walk through and the story kind of takes you through the walk, and most of the story happens in the graveyard. But what's lovely about it is you get this 3D kind of sound world. I think you get a sense of that. It's something very special when you hear the sounds and how they morph from very real things to quite imaginary things.
This is kind of quite a new venture for us, the Tiny Shoes. So it is quite exciting and it's quite new. We've not done anything quite like this before. I think it's quite surprising to a lot of our visitors. It's not something that they've expected, but it does add to their visit. It gives them something extra to do. Something quite interesting and extra. And also, of course, for us, it's been a great opportunity to work with West Yorkshire Playhouse.
The Brontes are always going to be in history. People are always going to come on and see them. But what's making it new and fresh?
Well, the whole season is about reframing their work and exploring their relevance to us today. And so we've got three productions which are all very new and fresh takes on their work, including a contemporary reimagining of Villette and a brand new rock musical about the Brontes called Wasted. And Tiny Shoes is an audio drama which explores the Brontes from a point of view of a big fan of the Brontes, which obviously a lot of people are.
For many of us, one of the first memories of going to school was being fitted for your school uniform. In Glasgow, one long-established outfitters has finally decided to pull down the shutters for the last time.
For many of Glasgow's parents and school kids, this shop behind me will have been the place to come to for school uniforms. But for R.W. Stevens, after 66 years, the family have decided it's the end of term. And before the shutters come down for good, let's go and meet some of the family.
My dad, before he started in the shop, he was working from the house and trying to build he was working in a normal job and then working from the house trying to start a business, which he eventually decided to take a chance I was born and brought up across the road, 89 Deanson Drive. He moved into the shop in 83 Deanson Drive, and we've been here ever since. It's a sad time in its own way, and we haven't been able to sell the business, and the family are all doing their own thing. Everybody's organising what they want to do in different careers. So it's fallen to us really to decide at what stage we decide to call it a day, and that has come.
It's a difficult decision to make, though, to close the family business.
To close the business down, it is a big decision. I mean, I'm not that old. As I say, my mum and dad both went on, well, dad went on into his 80s, and mum was still working away in her 70s until they weren't able to do that, you know. So it is a difficult time to think on it. And it seems to have, you know, 50 years, 60 years, it just shoots by. And my father always said, you don't need to have sales if you can avoid that. Don't do it. Give the customers a benefit of anything you want to sell. Put a board up, let them see it, and they get the benefit.
Well, you must have some good memories of this store, though.
Hey, lots of happy memories. There's nothing nicer than when you come in and you can fit somebody out for everything they require. If you can get something that somebody's wanting for their wedding and you know you've done your part, it's very nice.
That brings us to the end of the first half of the show and time for this week's quiz. Pinewood is home to one of the best known film studios in the world. In which of the home counties is it situated? Is it A, Buckinghamshire? B, Surrey? Or C, Berkshire? So sit back with your popcorn and we'll give you the answer after the break. Welcome back to Digital Nation. Before the break, we asked you, Pinewood is home to one of the best known film studios in the world. In which of the home counties is it situated? And the answer is A, Buckinghamshire. Pinewood has been the home of James Bond since 1962 and now has the Cubby Broccoli soundstage, one of the largest in the world. In Cardiff, the annual Iris Prize celebrates the expanding lesbian, gay, bisexual and transgender film industry. The chairman explains how, since its inaugural event 10 years ago, it's now created a single international platform, helping raise the profile of a new generation of LGBT filmmakers.
I was involved with the first Iris Prize. I was a judge, was asked to be a judge, and I remember saying to the organisers, I wonder if this prize will still be here next year, the year after. And who'd have thought, 10 years later, it's going stronger, bigger and better than ever before. We've now got 25 festival partners in 17 different countries. People are entering the Iris Prize from as far afield as Australia, India, China, all across Europe, of course, and Britain too. Interestingly, though, in 10 years, we've yet to have a British winner of the Iris Prize, and it's a pretty good prize to win, £30,000, to spend making a film here in Wales. People say to me sometimes, why do you need an LGBT festival? And I point out there are still 74 countries around the world where it's illegal to be gay. In some of those countries, you can be punished by death, hanging, being stoned to death. And also in Britain and in other parts of Europe, all around the world, sometimes it's very difficult for people to come out because of perceived homophobia, real-life homophobia. And that's why it's important that Iris tackles those issues and people can see these films and it helps them understand. And it's interesting too, the audience at the Iris Festival is 30% heterosexual, which is great, because it means we're not just gay people talking to gay people, we're talking to all sorts of people, all sorts of shapes and sizes. That's why it's really important we talk about homophobia, discrimination still at work, and there are still people, you know, who were alive when it was illegal to be gay. You know, next year is the 50th anniversary of the legalisation of homosexuality. Hard to think in my lifetime people were not allowed to be themselves. Unimaginable now, but of course, that's why still in 74 countries around the world, the same rules apply.
Pumpkins are something we mostly associate with Halloween. Although pumpkin soup and pumpkin pie are a tasty way to use the 150,000 crop growing in a field in Nottingham. With ideal weather conditions during the growing season, Notts TV went along to help gather them in.
I am going to the pumpkin patch to find the one for me.
So, Phil, I've never seen this many pumpkins in my life.
It's a huge amount. We've got over 150,000 pumpkins grown in this field. The field is the size of 30 football pitches, if you can get that in your mind. So over 150,000 planted, hoping for 120, 150,000 pumpkins back. The planting started in May. So these have been in the ground, sort of growing, open to the elements since May. So we've had some wet times, some dull times, and some sunny times as well, which has brought the crop to the fruition that we've got now. This is what we're aiming for a nice orange pumpkin, lovely shape, as we've got here. Although some of them haven't quite made it this year, up to yet. I don't think this one will have time to sort of mature in readiness for Halloween, but might come in for pumpkin soup or pumpkin pies.
The pumpkins are supplied to shops and supermarkets all over the county.
Well, in the Nottinghamshire countryside here, we have got some fantastic places, and the trees, as you can see around this field, it's lovely. And that helps with the crop to grow. It's sort of sheltered from the wind, because the plants don't like to be rocked about. Shelters from the wind, and they just seem to flourish on the sand land.
Well, it wouldn't be right leaving without picking a few pumpkins off my own.
Back in the 1980s, the Department of Finance and Personnel for Northern Ireland created a document detailing the actions to be taken in the event of a nuclear attack on the country. In Belfast, the declassified files worryingly reveal the chilling realisation that in reality, not a lot could be done for up to 80% of the UK population.
The document this month is a war plan from the Department of Finance and Personnel, which was, I think, from 1984 to 1988. Essentially, it details what action this government department would do in the event of a conventional or nuclear strike on Northern Ireland in the 1980s. So it's really from the department's point of view, how they would react, what they would do as a department to mitigate any circumstances in the event of a strike. So this was a government file from 1984 to 88, and it's about from the Department of Finance and Personnel's reaction itself. You know, they're saying they might have to put restrictions on the amount of money people can lift out in the event of a war. That is kind of the priority for that department at the time. Obviously, it would all go into a larger kind of government plan for what was going on from other different government departments. You get the sense it's like a firefighting almost document. It's kind of like what to do in the immediate aftermath of a conventional nuclear or biological strike. Basically, they might not be able to provide the necessities of life for people in the UK, for as much as 40 million people, which at that time was probably about 80% of the population. They couldn't guarantee the necessities of life in the event of a nuclear attack. In the context of the Belfast area, it does mention that a 3-megaton nuclear warhead could damage a radius as big as 13 miles outside Belfast. In the 1980s, not ready at all. Now, probably the same.
Time for Creative Kingdom. And did you ever wonder why you stick a stamp on your letter?
We all know that the first method of paying for mail started in London in the 1680s, but it took ages to work out how people should actually pay for it, and who for that matter. Sometimes it was the sender, and other times, the recipient. For many years, a hand-pressed stamp was used, but it didn't account for weight or size. But finally, along came the saviour of philatelists everywhere, Roland Hill, who came from Kidderminster. He licked the problem in 1837 after suggesting that all items of mail should be paid for by the sender, with a bit of paper just large enough to bear the stamp and covered at the back with a glutinous wash, and the idea stuck. This led to the creation of the world's first ever adhesive postage stamp, the penny black. Proof once again that when it comes to creativity, innovation, and leaving your stamp on the world, in Kidderminster Mint.
A crocodile can slow down its heart rate to 1 beat a minute, allowing it to stay submerged for 4 hours. Crocodiles of the World in Oxfordshire is staging CrocFest to help raise funds for a West African project to protect an endangered species of crocodile. With over 150 crocs, there's plenty of snappy events to keep the visitors entertained.
Crocodiles of the World was founded in 2011 by Sean Foggett. It currently has over 150 crocodiles and is home to 17 of the 23 species of crocodiles worldwide.
So it's all about fundraising for a particular project that we've chosen in West Africa called Project Mesostops for the African slender snouted crocodile.
And really, where better to host CrocFest than in the UK's only crocodile zoo? The event is going to be full of fun ways to raise money.
So we've got crocodile feeds going on. We have Meet the Alligators, so you can meet some of our alligators. We have a bucking crocodile ride that you can have a go on, which would be really cool. We're going to run a little league over the evening, so you can stay on it the longest. There's food and raffles and auctions are the other way we're raising money.
Did you know a crocodile can slow their heartbeat down to one beat per minute, which allows them to stay submerged underwater for up to 4 hours?
I don't really have a favourite individual or species anymore. I think just they're all just so fascinating, and each individual species has its own little quirky things about them, so I don't really have a favourite. It'd be like having a favourite child. You couldn't do it.
A recently discovered building in Moseley Park in Birmingham was originally thought to be an air raid shelter, which had become filled with soil. When the soil was removed, it was realised that it was actually an 18th century ice house, which served the nearby Moseley Hall. Now restored to its original condition, stories abound of it being the inspiration for Tolkien's Hobbit House.
Really glad to welcome you to Moseley Hall Ice House. It's in Moseley Park, and we're delighted to be able to show the public one of the most exciting places and certainly the very best ice house in the West Midlands. It was built, we think, about 1790. It served a big house up at Moseley Hall, which is now the hospital. In those days, all the land on this side of Ulster Road belonged to the Taylor family, and they could show off by having an ice house. It meant they could serve cooled wine and have elaborate desserts made because they could store ice in this amazing ice house all through the year. I always used to think it was an air raid shelter. It was just a boarded up hole in the side of the hill. But one of our members realised it was an ice house. It had been filled up with soil, and first of all, we raised money. We got it listed as a listed building, and we had professional builders restore the entrance, which was collapsing. And when it was done, this most amazing chamber was revealed, and we'd expected it might have been damaged with the weight of the soil, but there it was, in perfect condition.
When you look at the outside of it, it must have been Tolkien's influence for the Hobbit Hole. A grass bank with a door in the middle of it. You just look at what the Hobbit Hole used to look like.
Well, that brings us to the end of this week's show and your journey around the local TV channels. Don't forget, all the previous episodes are available on the BBC website, bbc.co.uk/digitalnation. And why not check out the website of your own local TV channel? So, until next week, goodbye.